That was lovely, amen. Our scripture this morning will be found in Micah chapter 5, verses 2 and 3. Word of God reads, "But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times. Therefore, Israel will be abandoned until the time when she who is in labor bears a son, and the rest of his brothers return to join the Israelites." May the Lord add a rich blessing to the reading of his word.
Well, good morning to everyone. I don't know about you, but it's already been a rich blessing just to be here so far. I especially love that song. Christina Rossetti, one of my favorite Victorian English poets, wrote the words to that. And she asks that great question, what can I bring him? And as if our hearts were nothing to bring, and yet it's everything. So I love the ending to that where it says, just bring him our hearts. And I hope this morning, as we journey a little bit towards that important event, that we will indeed be bringing our hearts. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for the opportunity to be here this morning, to worship you, to think particularly of the gift that you gave us, not just of your life here on earth, but the opportunity for each of us to have eternal life with you in heaven. I pray that you will bless us during this time, and then as we go out to celebrate those gifts with our families and our friends in the week ahead. In your name I pray this, amen. Way back when the world was brand new, God looked down at all that he had made and saw that it was good. It pleased him, made him happy. For now there was yet another world where he could share companionship and joy. For a while he found comfort in walking and talking with his friends in the garden, and they found security in his love. But then sin and separation. Adam and Eve were banished from the garden as Satan and the angels had been banished from heaven. God no longer walked and talked with them, and loneliness entered the world and the heart of God. They all were suffering, and they needed a way back to each other. You know the story, and you know the plan. You know that in order for us to live eternally, Christ had to die. God so loved the world that he would give up his own son, and that son, he too, would love the people in the world so much that he would give up his life for them, to suffer that others might live, to deny himself for those who are dearer to him than life. That is the true meaning of love. And that in the end was what would bring humanity back to be united with their God. But wait, I'm getting ahead of our story, and it is our story. Let me take you back to a night long ago, more than 2,000 years, in fact. In many ways, it was a night like any other. The stars were shining, but one in particular. In other ways, it was like no light, no night, no other night. For the events that followed would change the world forever. There were many travelers on the roads as the census had been ordered, and all were encouraged to return to their home villages to be counted. That included Joseph, the carpenter, and his betrothed, Mary, heavy laden with child. They were on their way to Bethlehem. If you were one of those other travelers and did not already know their story, you might wonder how Mary was heavy laden with child without the protection of marriage, and why she hadn't just stayed home, given her condition, instead of travel so far afield. But God had given several prophets the story to share with the people of their time, people like you and me. You should have known, I should have known, had I been there. From Isaiah, you would have heard the promise that God would be sending relief from the oppression of the world, that the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, God with us. From Malachi, you would have heard a more fleshed out prophecy, one that also addressed you or someone like you. I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his temple, even the message of the covenant whom ye delight in. Behold, he shall come, saith the Lord of hosts. The prophet Micah had even foretold where this great event would take place. You would have heard of Bethlehem and its ironic significance. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are too small to be among the army groups from Judah, from you will come one who will rule Israel for me. He comes from very old times, from days long ago. The Lord will give up his people until the one who is having a baby gives birth. Then the rest of his relatives will return to the people of Israel. Isaiah had commented on the state of the world, its sin, and its need of a savior, and how this baby born of a virgin would supply all their needs. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. So yes, they knew. If they had been paying attention to their prophets, they should have known. And yet when they read in Isaiah this challenge, they were not sure what to do. Comfort my people. Comfort them, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and announce to it that its time of hard labor is over and its wrongs have been paid for. It has received from the Lord double for all its sin. Go up a high mountain, Zion. Tell the good news. Call out with a loud voice, Jerusalem. Tell the good news. Raise your voice without fear. Tell the cities of Judah, here is your God. Later, after the Savior had come and gone, the writer of Hebrews would describe the news from the Old Testament prophets and its fulfillment this way. Long ago, God spoke to the fathers by the prophets at different times and in different ways. In these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. God has appointed him heir of all things and made the universe through him. So when it came time for the prophecy to actually be fulfilled, people knew or had the opportunity to know. They knew, and so did you, if you had been a traveler on the road to Bethlehem that momentous year. Yet in spite of everything, it still was a surprise. No one saw it coming. Those of us living a couple thousand years later can read what happened. Luke gives us the context. During Elizabeth's 6 month of pregnancy, he tells us, God sent the angel Gabriel to a virgin who lived in Nazareth, a town in Galilee. She was engaged to a man named Joseph from the family of David. Her name was Mary. The angel came to her and said, greetings, the Lord has blessed you and is with you. But Mary was very confused by what the angel said. Mary wondered, what does this mean? The angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, because God is pleased with you. Listen, you will become pregnant. You will give birth to a son, and you will call him Jesus. He will be great, and people will call him the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of King David, his ancestor. He will rule over the people of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. Mary said to the angel, "How will this happen? I'm a virgin." The angel said to Mary, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will cover you. The baby will be holy. He will be called the Son of God." Matthew shares his perspective on the story, saying that the birth of Jesus Christ happened like this. When Mary was engaged to Joseph, just before their marriage, she was discovered to be pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Whereupon Joseph, her future husband, who was a good man and did not want to see her disgraced, planned to break off the engagement quietly. But while he was turning the matter over in his mind, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife. What she has conceived is conceived through the Holy Spirit, and she will give birth to a son whom you will call Jesus, the Savior, for it is he who will save his people from their sins." All this to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," meaning God with us. Luke explains how it happened that Mary and Joseph found their way then to Bethlehem. About that time, Emperor Augustus gave orders for the names of all the people to be listed in record books. These first records were made when Quirinius was governor of Syria. Everyone had to go to their own hometown to be listed, so Joseph had to leave Nazareth in Galilee and go to Bethlehem in Judea. Long ago, Bethlehem had been King David's hometown, and Joseph went there because he was from David's family. Mary was engaged to Joseph and traveled with him to Bethlehem. Just imagine that journey if you were Mary. You're traveling a dark road on a cold winter night, unsure of any immediate plans, but you are positive of the momentous future that lies ahead for you and the child you carry, the child of God. Imagine the anxiety of both Mary and Joseph and what they must have felt as they traveled that road on their way to Bethlehem. Imagine the frustration of the innkeeper who was overrun with guests, desperate to find shelter from the cold winter night. Imagine what it was like for him to have to tell this clearly needy couple that he had no place but a manger for their soon-to-be-born child. Luke concludes his birth narrative like this: "And while they were there, she gave birth to her firstborn son. She dressed him in baby clothes and laid him on a bed of hay because there was no room for them in the inn." Now, my imagination tells me it was a lot more dramatic than this, but that's what we have from Luke. Years later, the child born that night in a stable would stand on a hillside and proclaim that the meek shall inherit the earth. And it was the meek who first heard the good news of Jesus' birth, the good news that we continue to celebrate today as we walk our own road to Bethlehem. It was the meek that were among the first to hear the good news of Jesus' birth as the shepherds were keeping watch over their flocks in a field near a path on the way to Bethlehem. But on this night, it was not just the meek that were on their way to Bethlehem. Indeed, the road was lined by shepherds and their flocks, but also carpenters and innkeepers, strangers and friends, paupers and even kings. Step by step and prayer by prayer, people came from everywhere on their way to Bethlehem. Every creature, great and small, journeyed to that humble stall on their way to Bethlehem. Luke goes on with his story, recounting something even now challenging to imagine. "Now there were shepherds nearby living out in the field, keeping guard over their flock at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone round them, and they were absolutely terrified. But the angel said, 'Do not be afraid. Listen carefully. For I proclaim to you good news that brings you great joy, and to all people. Today your Savior is born in the city of David. He is Christ the Lord. "This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in strips of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly, a vast heavenly army appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among people with whom he is pleased." When the angels left him and went back to heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, that the Lord has made known to us." So they hurried off and located Mary and Joseph and found the babe lying in a manger. When they saw him, they related what they had been told about this child, and all who heard it were astonished at what the shepherds said. But Mary treasured these words, pondered them in her heart, what they might mean. So the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. Everything was just as they had been told. Amazing, right? Imagine what it must have been like to be one of those shepherds, realizing that you had just witnessed the fulfillment of a prophecy, knowing that you had wondered if it would ever come true. You knew the promise, and now you knew the delivery of the promise. Amazing, right? As 21st century Christians, we travel a well-worn path that leads us towards life everlasting. Our path was started by the sandaled feet of a humble carpenter and hooves of a gentle donkey that carried the mother of Jesus. Our path was paved by the eager steps of all who have come to worship him and all who believe that in a lowly stable, in a tiny village, the Savior of all was born. In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. So the Word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's one and only Son. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Christmas time then celebrates this love, this gift of life, this reunion with God. We often tend to think of Christmas as more for children than anyone else, and perhaps there's some truth to that, but isn't there a little bit of the child in each of us? And isn't it the birth of a child that is at the heart of our celebration? Christmas is a celebration, and celebration is instinct in the heart. Through how many centuries now has that need in the heart found comfort and fulfillment in the Christ child? Through how many threatening circumstances has Christmas been celebrated since that cry came ringing down through the ages? "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." Christmas is celebration, but the traditions that cluster sweetly around the day have significance only if they translate the heart's intention, the yearning of the human spirit to compass and express faith and hope and love. Without this intention, the gift is bare and the celebration a touch of tinsel and the time without meaning. Faith and hope and love are the wellsprings, firm and deep, of Christmas celebration. These are the gifts without price, the ornaments incapable of imitation, discovered only within oneself and therefore unique. They are not always easy to come by, but they are in unlimited supply, even in the province of all. And so I ask you today, Are you on the way to Bethlehem? Just like many years ago, you and I can also go on our way to Bethlehem, hand in hand with God above, filled with his eternal love. We're all on our way to Bethlehem.